has given President Nixon four more days to respond to a subpoena for more materials. The sealed report from the Watergate grand jury will go to the House Judiciary Committee tomorrow. Former White House counsel...
By game's end, he had chalked up 40 points. But McAdoo's counterpart, Elmore Smith, an ex-Buffalo player, was enjoying the best night of his career. Not known as a great shooter, Smith continually found the range with 15 to 18-foot jumpers. On the night, he was 16 for 27 from the field and finished with 37 points. For the other Lakers, too, it was a fun night. Gale Goodrich, all year long the backbone of the team, had another fine evening. He finished with 35 points. Happy Harrison, the club's most consistent rebounder, enjoyed a season-high 29 points. Jimmy Price, the man who's been forced to try to fill the shoes of an injured Jerry West, tossed in 16 points, and in good Jerry West fashion, totaled 11 assists.
In spring training baseball, the White Sox lost to the Orioles 3-2 today. Jim Cott went five strong innings. In Arizona, the Cubs lead the Indians 6-5 there in the eighth inning. And bad news for two big league veterans today. The Cincinnati Reds sent sore arm pitcher Gary Nolan to their Indianapolis farm team. And former World Series hero Ron Swoboda was released by the Atlanta Braves. There's a heavyweight championship fight in Caracas, Venezuela tomorrow night. George Foreman will defend his title against Ken Norton. Former champ Joe Lewis says Foreman will win. There will be no radio or TV coverage, just closed circuit at some theaters and hotels in this area. The Chicago Metropolitan High School Hockey League had its semifinal playoffs yesterday. Survivors Deerfield and Willowbrook will meet for the A division title next Sunday, and it's Proviso West against Evanston for the AA title. The Chicago Aces of the New World Team Tennis League have signed a big name. Marty Reason, formerly of Hinsdale High School and Northwestern University, will be player coach for the Aces. One more baseball story. The Oakland A's are trying an experiment this spring. They've signed a sprinter, Herb Washington of Michigan State, as a possible pinch runner. Dick Hammer has the story.
Sprinter Herb Washington last played baseball in high school. The Michigan State star, world record holder in the indoor 50 and 60-yard dashes, signed last week with Oakland as a running specialist. His first day in camp included a refresher course on pickoff moves under the supervision of manager Alvin Dark.
I think really the main thing is getting him acclimated to standing at first base and watching the pitchers make different moves towards home and towards first. That's the main thing right now.
Washington got a look at the A's best, lefty Darryl Knowles.
And he has a pretty good move, doesn't he?
Oh, he sure does. He sure does. And they tell me he's the best in the business. So when you got somebody like that right there in your team, I know that I'll be ready for anyone else.
Did you begin to feel comfortable after the first couple of throws over there this morning?
I really did. You know, I kind of got loose, and it was a for real situation today because I'm sure that they know that if they can pick me off, that they should be able to pick off anyone else in the league. And I tell you, it's going to be a challenge right here in practice. I tell you, practice might be harder than some games for myself with Knowles and Lou and Odom and guys like that throwing over there.
Washington is assured of plenty of work this week. The A's have hired a tutor, former Major League Base stealing king Maury Wills of the Dodgers, to speed his development. Dick Hammer, NBC News, Mesa, Arizona.
And Jorie, that's all I have, unless there's something we haven't covered yet.
No, I have a question, though. Recently, some high school coaches and some girls in high school have contended that they should be allowed to play basketball with the boys' teams. What do you think of that?
I think it would be a mistake. I don't like to see discrimination against anyone, but I really don't think that girls would be competitive at that level, you know, against, say, 17-year-old boys. If you watch the state tournament over the weekend, there's some very strong, young 17-year-old boys. Proviso East won the title, and they're very fast, very strong. There may be room for, like, a high school league for girls and let mm-hmm. them compete with each other.
Yeah, separate but equal.
Yeah, something like that. I think it's a real danger of injury if a female gets out there because that's a very high-speed, rough sport.
Mm-hmm.
Wait, just safety's sake, that's all.
Would that hold true for most sports besides basketball, too?
No, non-contact sports. Competition sports like swimming, diving, skating, things like that, where it's just individual skill and you don't have to knock anybody down, I would imagine. Sure, it should be open to females, but something where you can get some bones broken, I would say no.
Okay.
I have a daughter. I wouldn't want her to play basketball with a bunch of boys.
Okay. Thank you very much, Bob.
You're welcome.
Harry Volkman will have the weather recap when the news continues.
Waitress, Wait.
There's something wrong with your peanut butter sandwich?
No, it's the potato chips. They're not Pringles.
Pringles?
Pringles, newfangled potato chips.
You brought your own potato chips?
Once you've tried Pringles, the potato chips just don't stack up.
Really?
I'll show you. A plastic lid for resealing. Crush-proof, too. Airtight stack pack, so the chips come out all fresh and unbroken. In fact, perfect. Because they're made a new way.
But this holds more.
No, as many chips as in that big bag. Taste them.
Me? Oh, my God.
Pringles, newfangled potato chips. Once you've tried them, other potato chips just don't stack up.
Pure wool,
vinyl trim,
three-piece knit pantsuits worth $90, now only $58 at William A. Lewis.
The big difference at Homemakers is this. It's not low-priced furniture. It's good furniture at low prices. You choose from America's famous brand names, displayed in 250 decorative room settings. And what you fall in love with today can be in your home tonight. Homemakers, not low-priced furniture, but good furniture at low prices. Homemakers, a division of John M. Smith, opposite Woodfield Shopping Center.
I'm Hugo Gibbons. I'm gathering part of my breakfast. The fruit of this prickly pear cactus will go well with grape nuts. Having spent years studying natural foods, I can recommend Post Grape Nuts. This crunchy cereal is made from natural ingredients, wholesome wheat and barley, and it's fortified with vitamins. Its naturally sweet taste reminds me of wild hickory nuts. I call grape nuts my back-to-nature cereal.
All this sub-freezing weather has endangered the entire commercial peach crop here in Illinois. A spokesman said the frigid temperatures have just about wiped out the peach crop throughout the Midwest. There's also the possibility that some of the apple crops may have been damaged. Harry, when is all this going to stop?
Well, it's moving out very quickly now, Jorie. I'm also concerned about Michigan's cherries and things. It was 3 below in Grand Rapids, Michigan this morning, and that's in the heart of the fruit belt, I believe, over there. Meantime, the warming is coming, Jorie, and we have now a low not too bad, 25 tonight, south winds 15. Tuesday, it will be up into the 40s again. It normally is 49 at this time of year. Right now, it's 44. It will be lightly northeast breeze coming off the lake, keeping it a little cooler there. And Tuesday night, partly cloudy, low 26. Late Tuesday night and early Wednesday, we may get a little bit of rain out of this situation, but it should warm up by Wednesday afternoon to near 50, and the balance of the week should be fairly pleasant the way it looks now.
Thank you, Harry.
Okay, Jerry.
Governor Dan Walker took a ride around the block today in Chicago in a car fueled by gasoline made from Illinois coal. It cost $4,000 to produce the 15 gallons of gasoline that Walker poured into the car's tank. That's about $266 a gallon. And the governor used about $66 worth in his drive around the block.
15 gallons of unleaded gasoline is the sole yield of the new process so far, and that process is hardly the model of efficiency. The coal was mined at two downstate sites, shipped to New Jersey where it was turned into crude oil, and then shipped back to Whiting, Indiana where it was refined into gasoline. The governor admits that the process is expensive, but he doesn't rule out the possibility that it could provide a new source of fuel and a new use for Illinois coal.
It's very high. Obviously, it's not economical at the present time. That's one of the reasons we want to get that demonstration plant from the federal government located here in Illinois. When we do it on a mass production basis, the cost will come way down.
The car started in spite of temperatures in the low 20s, and the governor drove off down LaSalle Street. But only time will tell whether the new process has a practical application. Rich Samuels, News 5.
Other possible uses for Illinois coal will be discussed at a two-day conference on coal scheduled to begin tomorrow morning here in Chicago. Illinois Lieutenant Governor Neil Hardigan proposed a state energy council today, which he says could provide common sense answers to state energy needs. The council would hold public hearings, then make recommendations regarding energy policy. It would be comprised of elected officials and private members. Several other states have similar policy councils now. The head of the Illinois State Police said today most motorists are obeying the new 55-mile-an-hour speed limit. But Superintendent Dwight Pittman added many truck drivers are not slowing down. He said police officers are having a difficult time catching the speeders because truckers use citizen band radios to warn each other of radar traps. I'll have more news right after this.
Come to the Florida Sunshine Tree. Right now, there are plenty of juicy, fresh Florida oranges available. Sweet Florida oranges, the juicy oranges, naturally nutritious and rich in vitamin C. They're great for eating at home or out of a lunchbox. And don't forget, nothing beats them for squeezing, too. Pick a juicy bite of Florida Sunshine from the Florida Sunshine Tree.
See if you can guess what car this is just by looking at the inside.
Everywhere you look, there's luxurious detail, from the crushed velour upholstery right down to the plush carpeting. And all this luxury is standard.
What car do you think this is?
Wrong. It's a little Dodge Dart, the new Dart Special Edition. All the luxury you could ask for in a car with a great reputation for dependability. Dart Special Edition, the luxurious new little car from Dodge.
This is General Electric's king-size toaster oven. It's more than just a toaster. It lets you do a lot of things fast, like automatically toasting four slices of bread in less than 2.5 minutes, or top browning four cheese sandwiches, or 35 party snacks, like baking 6 potatoes, or eggplant parmesan, or a frozen dinner. The toaster oven from General Electric. In king-size or regular, it's more than just a toaster, and it's fast.
You coax the blues right out of the home lane. You chime the husk right off of the corn lane. You got the banjo strumming and plucking out.
Lucille Ball is Maine. She'll coax the blues right out of your heart. Rated PG.
See Maine Friday at 5 Chicago area theaters.
The state of Illinois and a legal assistance group agreed today on regulations to improve the care of young people in mental health department facilities. The Legal Assistance Foundation had charged in a suit that youths do not receive adequate care in the state institutions. With today's agreement, the suit was dropped, although an attorney for the group said they may sue again to ensure that the regulations are followed.
The regulations themselves are not self-effecting. What they do is require, is to impose a legal duty on the departmental officials. And if those departmental officials want to comply with the law, that is, if they want to make sure that there's going to be a coherent and comprehensible treatment plan for a child, if they want to make sure that doctors and not aides are administering very powerful psychotropic drugs to adolescents in state mental hospitals, then they'll have to comply with the regulations.
An assistant Cook County state's attorney said today that he is conducting a thorough investigation of allegations that members of the Atwood Heights School Board misused public funds. The school district serves parts of Marionette Park, Oak Lawn, and Alsip. A citizens group had charged that school board members attending an education conference last spring in California used $13,000 in school funds to finance a trip to Disneyland. County School Superintendent Richard Martwick called last Friday for the resignations of all the board members. So far, 2 board members have resigned. Only 1 Chicago area child is still hospitalized with Reye's syndrome. A 16-year-old Calumet City girl is listed in satisfactory condition today at Children's Memorial Hospital. So far, 24 youngsters have been successfully treated for the non-contagious disease, which is usually associated with a viral infection. The mysterious ailment is blamed for 12 deaths in the Chicago area. Chicago Police Superintendent James Rochford met this afternoon with leaders of some policemen's organizations in an effort to improve relations between those groups and the police department's top command. After the meeting, some of the organization leaders would say only that some progress had been made. Rochford had no comment for Newsmen. A Cook County coroner's jury ruled today that the January 25th deaths of Mrs. Sandra Thompson and four of her children in a fire were accidental. They died of smoke inhalation when the blaze raced through their south side home. The father of the family, James Thompson, is still hospitalized with burns over half of his body. The jury has ruled that Robert Kujawa was in a deranged state of mind when he shot and killed himself in a Michigan Avenue bank on January 11th. Kujawa had demanded money from a bank official when he found his safety deposit box locked by court order. He held three people hostage for a time, but then released them unharmed. Then he shot himself. Two defendants in the trial of 10 narcotics agents in Alton, Illinois, were acquitted today on four counts of civil rights violations. But the judge said the pair still face conspiracy charges. The 10 are charged in connection with warrantless drug raids made last spring. The judge in the case also denied a motion for a mistrial during today's session. The dissension-ridden Illinois Bureau of Investigation is undergoing an extensive reorganization. An aide to Governor Walker confirmed today that a house cleaning was in progress, but he declined to call it a purge. The Bureau has been criticized recently for chronic leadership problems. The Supreme Court ruled today that a federal court cannot impose a financial liability on a state treasury. The issue arose when a lower federal court ordered the state of Illinois to make retroactive payments to participants in a federal state aid program. Payments were awarded by the lower courts when Cook County and the state were sued for allegedly mismanaging the program. The Supreme Court said that the state is protected from such legal action under the 11th Amendment. Needy students at Chicago's Roosevelt University are now receiving financial aid from an anonymous donor. The donor is believed to be a fellow Roosevelt student.
Roosevelt University on Michigan Avenue has about 600 foreign students. Many of them live and work on the school campus, and over the years, problems at home and unstable foreign exchange rates have put some of them in financial trouble. On March 7th, an American student who some believe lives on the campus pledged $130,000 to be used for foreign students with financial troubles. The school has already received $64,000 of the pledge. It was sent to school president Dr. Rolf Wild, and the donor wishes to remain anonymous.
I think students are amazed that among our own students, there is one who is in a position to give away that much money. They're baffled by it. They're certainly pleased. And I think it's terrifically reassuring to think that someone is willing to give away that much money.
I could feel much more better if I could see someone and say thank you. But I still feel better if I can say thank you to maybe the anonymous giver.
I'm very grateful to this behavior, and I make up my mind. Someday if I had the chance, I'll help the stranger in the foreign country, or in my country too.
There's a lot of talk around the school about the affluent student, whoever he is, but no one wants to expose him because that might end his generosity. Russ Ewing, News 5.
That's the news for now. Join Jim Ruddle at 10 o'clock this evening. Have a good evening.
Channel 5 editorial reply follows immediately. This is a reply to a WMAQ-TV editorial. Here's Jim Vidopel, a spokesman for the Illinois State Rifle Association.
On March 19th and 20th,